Good evening, wonderful beings of light and love. This is another edition of Health and Soulful Being. I'm your host, Renee Angela, and we are celebrating Black History Month with the Black History Makers right here in our community. And I am so honored and so thankful that I am able to have this history maker right here beside me, Mr. Ernie Westfield, poet, author, and Negro baseball leaguer. So we're going to talk a little bit about all of his accomplishments throughout his time and throughout his life, and as he still continues to press on and help us learn and know what it was like to be a history maker. Welcome, Mr. Westfield. Thank you so much for coming in and being on my show tonight. So let's see, where shall we start? So you were born around what, towards the end of the Depression era?
I was born in 1939, and I signed a contract with the Cubs in 1960.
Okay, so you were right in the helm of the Civil Rights Movement, and
I'm gonna be honest with you. I didn't keep track of no civil rights stuff or anything. All I wanted to do was play baseball, I really knew it and didn't know anything about it, all this stuff that was going on. But back in the day, I was born in Cleveland, Tennessee, and raised in Knoxville, Tennessee.
Okay. So. And what was the climate like in Tennessee at that time?
It was pretty good. The only thing I didn't like about it is that my grandfather owned a cotton farm. So he had me picking cotton. And I'm going to tell you, the only thing I liked about that is they grew watermelons in the field. And I would get me a watermelon and carry it all over the place the whole day. Until they dumped it out the wet, and everybody pounced on my watermelon.
Oh.
But another thing happened is that we played baseball among ourselves. And then the coach got a call that they wanted us to come and play their team. But the coach from the other team didn't know we were Black. So when we got there, he said, y'all stay in the car here and everything. He walked up and talked to the man. I could tell the way the manager was talking that, hey, this wasn't good for him. And here comes back to the car. He said, they thought we were a different color, But that was okay, because that's why I signed my contract. I was the first Black in Cleveland and Knoxville, Tennessee to sign a contract.
Oh, wow. And how old were you when you signed the contract to play for the Cubs?
See, I probably think I was real young.
Organization, not the Cubs.
About 16.
Yeah.
And I was all over the place, and then the newspaper, they wanted to take my picture and everything. And they were going to fly me to Mesa, Arizona.
Okay.
And I'd never been on a plane before in my life. And so it was me and another white kid from my town, and we became the best of friends. So they gave us plane tickets to fly to Mesa. And we got there, and they announced that they couldn't land, because something was wrong, and they might have to make a belly landing, so they're going to use up all the fuel.
Okay.
I said, oh, my gosh.
Okay.
I'm talking to myself. I said, wait a minute here now. You know, I kept looking out the window, and so this other kid with me said, Ernie, I can see the headlines now. Two local youth killed in an airplane crash. Oh, no. Yeah. We both had that accent, but, we just stayed together all the time, because at the end, we practiced every day.
Okay.
And it was so hot in Mesa, Arizona.
Oh, yeah.
That after we finished practice, I would go to the pool hall. So I didn't think anything about it. And we went down there and came through the door, and the hand came down like that. It stopped me, but allowed my friend to go on in, And he had this southern accent. He said, if Irony can't come in, I'm not going in. So he went with me, And I really appreciate that. But do you know the guy that's the that handles the license stuff? I can't think of his name. Black dude. He runs for office all the time. But anyway,
I'm at a complete loss.
He was in Mesa, Arizona with me.
Oh wow!
But he's now over this big stuff here in Illinois. Yeah, it was something. And I got $300 to sign with the Cubs. And I love my mother so much, I gave her every bit of it.
Oh.
I gave it to her. I eventually had to move my mother down from New York, and I had to go get her. And I didn't know I was going to cross this bridge called the Washington Bridge. You ever been over?
I haven't been over to Washington Bridge,
oh, don't,
no.
Don't. I'm going to tell you, and I was in charge of the employment office here for the state of Illinois. And I was telling this guy, I just got a service. He said, Ernie, I'll go with you. So we go up, and just as soon as I saw the bridge, I got nervous. I said, oh, my gosh.
Yeah, they make me kind of nervous, too.
Oh, I don't like it. And so I was
I don't like to be sent suspended in midair with only water below me.
But here's what my friend said. He said, Ernie, I don't know why you panic. He said, if that bridge would fall in, you'd be dead before you hit the water. I said, well.
Oh, gosh. Well, that makes you feel a lot better.
Right. I said, no. And I'm going to tell you, I would shut my eyes. And who just said, are we there yet?
You know, are we across the bridge?
Yeah, I had that kind of fear, you know. And but everything worked out good. I moved my mother here. And I gave her a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and I was sad to see her go. But she was good.
Yeah.
I mean, I had some other brothers, but I was a favorite.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, because of everything that I've done in this town here, I had a radio show.
Yep.
Okay, but you know what? I went down to the News Gazette because they were telling me they saw my picture in the paper. And I went down, I said, can you see if you put another picture of me out there? And she said, you on the radio, aren't you? I said, yeah. She said, when are you going to go back? I said, I don't know if I'll go back. My husband and I stayed up late at night just to listen to your show. Everywhere I go, they were telling me that.
Uh-huh.
And I was out to the Kentucky Fried Chicken. And some of the roughest dudes came in there. They saw me. Hey, how you doing? I said, I'm doing great. You know, and I kept talking to them and everything. And when they got ready to leave, here's what they said. Sorry. Here's what they said. They went, we love you, Mr. Westfield. You got us all jobs. I said, oh, okay. You know, I never had a man to say that to me before.
Right.
You know, but it's just so much. And everywhere I go, a lot of places I go, they don't even charge me.
Mm-hmm.
They give me something. Hey, there's a lady, and she's a minister. Joyce Myers. You ever watch her on TV?
Oh, yes, I do.
I was over, what was that? I was over someplace in Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
And I stopped at the restaurant to eat. Next thing I know, this guy come, he said, this is on this lady over there. It was Joyce Meyer.
Wow.
I haven't had to do too much of anything. People would do things. I went to get my car fixed. The guy said, no, I will take care of this for you. Don't worry about it. I said, what have I done to deserve this? You know, and it's just something. I'm just happy.
Oh, my goodness. So here you are at 16 years old and being signed. What was it like to be a teenager going into young adulthood, being signed, being recognized, starting to be recognized as a baseball player and having a new set of fame? How was that for a young man?
Well, it was different because when I went to Mesa, Arizona, I never saw lemons grow on a tree. They had all these
fruit. It's too hot, isn't it?
You know, they had all these fruit trees there. Mm-hmm. You know, I went over in people's yard and started pulling them off and tasting them. I've never seen a lemon grow like that. And
now it's all cacti.
Yeah. And it was just nice that I got there. Only thing I didn't like is that we had to find some other teams to play during that time.
Mm-hmm.
And they took them to a prison. They had a big prison up there in Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened, they count you when you come in, and the same number better come out.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I was a little scared of that. I said, let me get in front. Let me be the first one
right,
to get out.
First one to get in and first one to get out.
Yeah. But you know what? This year, this is what the jerseys looked like back then. This is for the Kansas City Monarchs.
Oh, wow. This is the official leaguer.
You see where it says Satchel Paige?
Sure. Ah. Ooh.
Satchel Paige. Yes. Satchel Paige, I mean, he could throw that ball so hard. I used to watch him, you know.
Yes.
And how he was throwing that ball, that's how I learned to throw the knuckle curve.
Okay.
From him. And this is the team. This is the one for our team. And I don't know if you can tell me who played for this team, but once you hear the name, Birmingham Black Barons. Willie Mays.
So what was it like, all of these icons of baseball, like Satchel Paige, Willie Mays, and just so many, and Jackie Robinson. Mm-hmm. What was it like playing alongside these men?
Well, I didn't know Satchel Paige that well.
Mm-hmm.
But I watched him pitch, and then I started to read about his history and everything. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, he came here.
Oh, I didn't know that.
He came here. They had a pitcher at the University of Illinois that went into the pros,
mm-hmm.
and so he came here to pitch against him.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I brought a picture of him someplace, him and the guy that he's pitching against.
Uh-huh.
But he was really, really good. I mean, he could put that ball anywhere he wanted to put it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm sitting there watching him. What was that you threw? So the knuckle curve, you grip it like this right here, and this finger, what it does, when you really curve it, you pull this one like that, and it goes and comes and turn over like that.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, Tennessee Ernie.
You said what? Yeah. Well, you know.
So you were learning different techniques from these men.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know what? I got a letter the other day from my hometown.
Mm-hmm.
They want me to come down, and they want to put me into the Knoxville Hall of Fame.
Oh, wonderful.
I ain't going back. I'm not going back.
Well, why not?
Because I left this girl back there, and I didn't write her. She got mad at me and everything, so she might still be mad. I'm not going back.
And how long was that?
Huh?
How long ago was that?
It was a long time, but you can never tell.
Okay, yeah, because we women can hold a grudge now.
Sure. You know, because the thing is that my name was all in the paper and everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was the first black to ever sign a baseball contract out of Knoxville.
Oh, wow.
First
yes.
Black to ever do that.
Yes.
And I really appreciated that because, you know, I stuttered so bad. I said, who in the world going to listen to me? You know,
mm-hmm.
and I like that, and next thing I know, they were gone. They walked away. I was still trying to get the first word out.
Right.
But I did go back because the University of Tennessee in Knoxville,
mm-hmm.
That was right across the street from where I live, they wanted me to come back and talk to the team and everything. I did that.
Okay.
But
great.
I'm going to tell you, life has really been good for me. Like, things just fall into your hand. You don't have to even ask for it, you know, particularly in this town here.
Mm-hmm.
In this town right here. I went to a restaurant. And he came up and said, this is for you. I said, me? I said, how much owe you? He said, owe you nothing. It's already been paid for. I said, okay, you know. But all these good things just happened.
Mm-hmm.
They happened. And matter of fact, I was on the radio for, 14, 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
I went down to the News Gazette because some guys told me that your picture was in the paper. So I go down, and she couldn't find it. She found one, but she said, I can't find another one. And then she said, let me tell you something. She said, why did you leave the radio station? I said, well, it was time for me to go. She said, my husband and I would stay up half the night just listening to your show. It's like everywhere I go.
Mm-hmm.
And then my
You're being recognized.
Yeah, and then my grandson, he's what, 6'7", good basketball player, good mm-hmm. baseball player, fast. But he's kind of running a little slow right now. But the thing is that my daughter is assistant principal at Bottenville School here in town. And so I kind of watch out for him. And what happened, I said, Glenn, are you kicking? You going to go to school today? He said, I don't know. I said, you going, because I'm taking you. I said, I'm taking you. And so what happened is
sounds like my daughter, maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe.
What I had to do is that my daughter hadn't put my name on his health thing.
Mm-hmm.
So the doctor wanted him on a printout on everything. So I went down to Chris to get it. He said, your name's not here, so you can't get it. So this lady overheard me. She said, weren't you on the radio before? I said, yeah. Do you want it? I'll get it for you. She got it for me.
Oh, wow. It's so amazing that when you're on the radio, how people recognize you.
Well, you know, the reason I did that is back in those days, I mean, they had some gangs around here.
Mm-hmm.
They had some gangs in this town. And so what happened, I switched my time for my show to be at night.
Mm-hmm.
And for them to talk to me, they had to call me from home.
Ah.
Otherwise, they were on the street.
Right.
And so they would call me, and matter of fact, I was playing softball with the Peystone Rangers.
Mm-hmm.
That's a game that was around here. And every time I had something, they would be there. Matter of fact, the University of Illinois. I had a talent thing out there,
mm-hmm.
and the kids, we would rehearse before we came. And so the university gave me the whole auditorium.
Wow.
And then I started a summer program for kids. The university gave me $50,000 to run that for them.
Oh, wonderful.
And a lot of those kids that went through that program mm-hmm. are off to college.
The contributions that you have made and is making already. It's just mm-hmm. phenomenal. Mm-hmm. You have some other memorabilia here too. This big old framed picture right here that's on the easel, I'd like for you to talk about the one that says every other Sunday. Tell us a little bit about that one.
Because we had this park every other Sunday. That's on how we could get it.
The Birmingham Black Barons.
Same thing that Willie Mays came from. Mm. But you know what? The thing is, when I go into the schools, I said, look at these cars here. These are Cadillacs, but they go way back.
Yeah.
And I said, look how people are dressed. Up in the, I said, I tell you what, I got $2 in my billfold. If you can show me a kid with the pants sliding down behind, I'll give you this $2. They couldn't find one. They couldn't find one. But you know, it changed a lot.
Mm-hmm.
It changed a lot.
Yes.
I'm going again.
We're just going to move a little bit up on the... Yeah, I'll do that. We'll just move you up a little bit. There we go. That should be good.
And they really, the parents really like that.
Mm-hmm.
They really like that. See, I'm glad to hear you say that.
So yeah.
You say something, they don't even listen to us.
Well, of course.
But I don't know. I just couldn't believe it. Matter of fact, my wife, a friend of mine, we went to Roosevelt University in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And now the lady that went with me, she's over personnel here on campus.
Mm-hmm.
So my wife was just sitting at home watching the stories. I said, you need a job. I said, you need a job. So I sent it to my friend on campus. The next day, she was working.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. We were good friends when we were at Roosevelt.
Mm-hmm.
And she's been there for about almost 20 years.
Almost phenomenal. 20 years. Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
Really something.
Yeah.
Here's Rube Foster. Did I tell you about him?
No, I'm not familiar with him, so.
That's Rube Foster.
So this was a stamp done in 2010?
It's a stamp. I bought a whole bunch of them.
Oh, wow.
You got the stamp too?
No.
Okay, well see, the post office had me to come to unveil this.
Okay.
It was packed with people.
Mm-hmm.
And I read my portion and everything and told them about Rube Foster. Rube Foster was he died up in Chicago.
Okay.
And, maybe I'm doing it again.
No, we're here. Mm-hmm. Just kind of turn it a little bit.
Okay, you okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, the thing is that, but he was in an insane asylum up in Kankakee.
In an insane asylum?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For what?
I guess he must have had a breakdown or something. But that place is still up there.
Mm-hmm.
My wife and I go up for quite a bit. You know, we don't go to that, but we go to the stores up there in that area.
Okay.
And Rube Foster, he was the one who founded the Negro League.
Wow.
And he's buried up at 123rd and something in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people didn't even know that. Matter of fact,
founder of the Negro League. Wow.
But what happened is that they asked me to come to throw the ball out up in Kankakee.
Mm-hmm.
And I went by the place where he had to go, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the people in Kankakee didn't even know he had died. He was the one that started the league.
Now, did you ever personally meet him?
Nope.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
And now he's on a stamp.
I bought a whole bunch of those stamps.
Yes.
Well, see, that's what our kids need to understand. Get something that's good now. It'll be worth more as they get older.
Yes.
You know.
But not only that, let's start recognizing our heroes in history,
mm-hmm,
you know, because I did not know this information.
Mm-hmm.
So how many other people out there do not know this kind of information?
Well, locally they do.
Okay.
Locally they do. The thing is that I think we only have about 2 players left.
From the original?
From the original. From the Negro League.
Wow.
I'm one of them.
Yes. And the other?
He's up in Chicago someplace. But you know what? I had another thing I wanted to show you.
Mm-hmm.
This guy, Rube Foster, started all this stuff. Let me see if I got it. Is it in here someplace? I thought I had it.
Here, I can take that and set it down.
Let me see.
We will do that right over here.
They had a lot of players who got on the bus that said that they played, but they never even played.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Just was on the bus?
They was on the bus. And so when they started giving out, you know, money to the players.
Mm-hmm.
That's when they found out about it.
Because yeah. You wasn't on the paycheck.
Mm. Yeah. They're not real players.
Mm-hmm.
They dressed up like a player, but they wasn't players. I mean, it was really something. You know, we had one guy.
Oh, they just wanted to get the girls.
I don't think that helped him at all. I don't think that helped him, but it's just that so much stuff was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And now I do just about everything. This is the White Sox park.
Yes.
And then the Cubs had me to come up to saying, take me out to the ball game.
So
they found out I was a radio announcer. Thought I could do it a lot mm-hmm. better. But this was a former manager. He's now down in Florida.
Okay, so the guy here.
No, he was a legitimate player.
Okay, so
he
these
for the
two.
Kansas City Monarchs.
Okay.
Yeah, but the rest of them, I don't know why they even do it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, why would you fake something? Why would you fake it?
I don't know.
And I was up in Chicago at a big mall, and I had all my stuff on the table.
Mm-hmm.
And this one guy took something that was important to me. He had somebody put his picture on there instead of mine, too. And but I guess he filmed it in there. I've never seen anything like that.
We're in the age of Photoshop.
I said, what? Yeah, it was really something. You know, I enjoyed everything by the kids. Before I go in and they follow right behind me.
Mm-hmm.
With the Westfield, you know. Can you sign this for me?
Oh.
Sure, I don't mind doing it. But I sign up a whole bunch of stuff so when I don't have to get rushed, you know, when I do it.
Right.
And it's just so much. And businesses, they give you food for free when you're in there. They find out who you are, you know, and this is on us. This is on us, you know. And it's really something. But most of the people that listen to my radio show was mostly all black, but I didn't know there was some whites listening to it, too.
Oh, yeah.
This lady, she said, why don't you come back on the air? I stayed on till about 12 at night. But I played music for lovers and losers.
Oh, goodness.
That's what I did. I played for lovers and losers. And then I had a friend of mine that would call me on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
Never could get a girlfriend. He would call me every week. I'm still sucking. I don't have a girlfriend. I'm looking for one. You know. And people really like that.
The lovers and losers.
Yeah.
Well, let's kind of move in a different direction, because not only were you a baseball leaguer, but you are also a poet.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me, when did you get the inspiration to start writing poetry?
When I was stuttering.
And how old were you at that time?
Oh, I was very young. I figured if I write it, I could read it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because sometimes you bump into new words and you stutter, you can't do anything. But
right.
Yeah. Well, when I was in school, It's funny how I got caught, though, because what happened, every day you had to read a paragraph.
Mm-hmm.
They would give you the paragraph to read and give you when you, and put in the spot that you're going to read in. And so I'm sitting up there, and I know I'm supposed to read it this time. And when they called my number, and two kids didn't show. So I had to read something that you hadn't prepared. It was embarrassing. I used to like this girl. She said, you can't even talk. You
know? Oh, yeah. Wow.
I mean, it was embarrassing. When I signed the contract, the same girl came out there, congratulations. I said, well, you couldn't congratulate me when I couldn't read.
Couldn't talk.
I'd accept that. But it was really something. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And when I left there to get on the plane, a whole bunch of people were there to send me off and everything. And because I really didn't like myself. I cried a lot.
Mm-hmm.
My mother, I told you what she said about Moses.
Yeah.
And I said, let me go on and do this and try it. But I was one of the best students to come out of Roosevelt University in psychology.
Oh, wow.
The lady told me, she said, you're natural.
Mm.
And so when I retired from state here, a principal called me from a school. He said, Ernie, they need you. I said, who? She said, Cunningham Children's Home.
Mm-hmm.
I said, they need me? She said, yeah. He said, they want you to come over. I went over there, turned that whole program around.
Wow.
I had a kid, the university gave me some girls from the university because they wanted to shadow me.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was up in the cafeteria just looking out, making sure they were doing the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
And this one boy jumped into a dumpster. Jumped in it. And one of the girls tried to pull him out.
Okay.
Tried to pull him out. And so I asked the lady in the cafeteria, you got candy? She said, yeah. So I go down, I said, hey, Jimmy, what you doing in this dump thing? This is my home, Mr. Westfield. I said, you gonna sleep in all that junk? I said, I bought you a piece of candy, but I can't give it to you. Oh, you can't give it to me? I got to come out to get it? I said, sure, come out and get it. He came out, I said, let me tell you something. I'm not supposed to give you this candy. So when we get back to the cottage, you have to have this all eaten up. I'll do it, Mr. Westbrook. I'll do it.
Aww.
So we were on the way back, and he stopped. I said, oh, my gosh, what's going to happen? I said, Jimmy, what's wrong? You told me to make sure it was all eaten up before we got back. When I got him back in the cottage, it was all over.
Wow.
But I started some things over with Cunningham.
Mm-hmm.
If the boys were acting up, I said, look, let's go outside and let me throw you some pictures. Mr. Wester, you going to hit me? I said, I haven't hit anybody since yesterday. I said, yeah. And so the principal, he said,
you might have some good luck today.
Yeah. The principal said, Ernie, how in the world are you doing this? Because I had one kid, his father was a big-time professor at the University of Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't want to come to school.
Mm.
So I went by, I had an old pickup truck. I said, hey, I need some help. He said, what's wrong, Mr. Westfield? I said, I need some spark plugs put in my truck. Oh, I can do it. I said, okay.
Wow.
So I got him back to school. And I went into one of the grocery stores. That's Mr. Westfield. He didn't want to put me on the right track.
Oh.
Real loud. You know, but just to be able to think of things like that.
Yes.
Yeah. And
the appreciation.
Oh, yeah. And then I went out to Myers and did something. They was in the store there. He brought his girlfriend over there, and they started talking to you. But they turned out good.
Mm. Well, that's
real good.
Wonderful, wonderful stories. I love to hear stories like
that.
Really? I do, mm-hmm. because, you know, so many kids are in trouble, and all they just need is somebody who mm-hmm. is concerned about them to let them know you matter.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's usually just really all that they need. Mm-hmm. And so.
And they would do anything for you.
Yes, exactly.
Once they start to like you, they'll do anything for you.
Absolutely.
Well, the reason I started doing the things at Douglas Center, because there was a game called the Peace Stone Rangers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember.
So I brought my whole setup to Douglas Center.
Mm-hmm.
And we would have things at night. Zayers gave me bicycles. Penny's gave me bicycles. Sears gave me bikes. I had so many bikes. I used them as gifts.
Mm-hmm.
And so eventually, I went to the park district. I said, I want to move it outside.
Mm.
And they said, Ernie, we might have some trouble. I said, well, I don't think you're going to have any trouble. So they gave me this big open thing. You open it up, and I had a dance contest.
Mm-hmm.
And it would go on for the summer.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I had to keep them.
To get a bike.
Yeah. And so what happened, the dancers, they were coming from Danville all over, so getting into the dance thing. And I had judges and everything. And at the end of the summer, that's when they got the prize.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Westbrook, can we do that again?
Oh.
I said, well, maybe do it again next year. So I said, well, I might even be here.
Well, before we close for the evening, mm-hmm. I do want you to read one of your poems.
Have I read Walter Payton?
So, no, you haven't read Walter Payton yet.
Okay.
And
okay.
So this one is, and if you don't know Walter Payton, then you are not an Illinoisan. Let's just put it that way.
Well, you know what?
Sweetness himself played for the Chicago Bears.
Well, he came down with an illness.
Yes.
It eventually killed him. And what happened is I call him, his name was, they already called him Sweetness, so I called him Sir Sweetness. And so his wife and I unveiled this. We unveiled it.
All right.
And so.
And we're going to read it today.
And it says.
On air.
Sir Sweetness. When you were born, it was a special day, and that's why God said, I'll be with you always. So when things happen in life and you think people don't care, just remember God said he would put no more on us than we can bear. So Sweetness, the prayers are there for you and have been there all the time. Just put your trust in God and everything will be fine. So no matter what some people say, it's now in God's hands, and he delivers because it's part of his plan. So rejoice in the Lord because a blessing is on its way. And just like Wonder Dog, God will save the day. So let not your heart be troubled, Sir Sweetness. God knows about you and all your kindness. But just remember that God has worked through others for the things that he wants to do. Now the huddle has been formed, the play has been called, and this time God will give the ball to you.
Mm. Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so, so much.
That's
we could probably talk another half an hour,
okay.
But we are almost out of time.
Mm-hmm.
What's next for you? What are you going to do next?
You know, I was just thinking about that.
Mm-hmm.
My poems.
Your poems.
The guy called me, and it's called, I can't think of the name. They wrote me a letter.
Of the publishing company?
Publishing company. It's out of Chicago.
Okay.
And they first offered me $50,000 for my poems.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, $50,000? I said, that's not enough. They're going to make millions off of it.
Right.
You know? And I said, no, I turned it down. And I said, there's a friend of mine that's over in Bloomington, and she published her own book. So I'm going to go over and stay 5 days, and she said, we're going to get this book ready.
All right. So, and when you get this poetry book ready, we got to have to have you back, and I want the first copy.
You want the first copy?
I want the first copy.
Yeah.
So, Mr. Westfield, thank you so much
That's
for coming on my show. I just love all of this. Mm-hmm. That's right, the History Makers. As always, I'm sending blessings and love, peace, and eternal bliss. Take care.